Sing Sing.
The date is November 10th, 1999. The survivor, Feliks Gross, last name at birth, Gross. Interviewer, Martha Fraser. City, New York. Country, United States of America. The language is English.
My name is Martha Fraser, M-A-R-T-H-A-F-R-A-Z-E-R. Today is November 10th, 1999. This is an interview with Feliks Gross in New York, New York, United States of America, in the English language. Please state and spell your name.
Feliks Gross, F-E-L-I-K-S, my first name, the second. Family name is G-R-O-S-S.
Was this your name at birth as well?
That's right.
What is your birth date and your current age?
June 17, 1906. And my current age, you can count from that very easily.
I believe it's 93.
93, yeah.
Please tell us the city of your birth and spell it.
Krakow.
How would you spell that?
In Polish, it's Kraków. K-R-A-K-O-W.
And that is in which country?
In Poland.
Please tell us the names of the members of your immediate family, your parents and your siblings.
My father is Dr. Adolf Gross. My mother was Augusta Gross. My oldest brother was Maximilian. Then my sister Felicitas or Felicia. Then Otto Gross, Zygmunt, Ludwig Gross, and myself. And then Marysia, Maria Gross, Maria Victoria in reality.
Please tell us about your father.
My father went to the classic gymnasium, St. Anna. By the way, the same gymnasium Joseph Conrad went, about the same time even. About 4 or 5 years difference. Only Joseph Conrad was a dropout, my brother, father not. And then he went to the Jagiellonian University in Krakow, studied law, and was a doctor of jurisprudence, and opened a law office. He was member of the Austrian parliament, elected by the largely by the Jewish population, but later by the Polish and Jewish population jointly, but first Jewish population. In the first election, which was general franchise, you know, open election, rather young age, and also member of the council of the city of Krakow, very active in the social field. He was advancing public housing very early, author of the public housing law of Austro-Hungary, which carried his name, was one of the first laws of this type, first institution in Europe, public housing, supported by the government, by the municipalities. My father didn't like the government, liked to organize by self-government. And was also active in many other fields in this city. He was he failed the Polish election when the Zionists were elected. A Zionist representative from Krakow, Dr. Ton, was elected when the nationalism was very strong, Polish and Jewish. My father was the last thing was nationalism. Very tolerant of other nationalities, very tolerant of other religions. And nationalism was, for him, very foreign to his nature and personality.
Did you have family on his side living in Krakow?
In Krakow with my mother, Augusta, who was from Silesia, or from the part of Poland close to Silesia, you know. And then very close to us, we lived, was my uncle Zabielski, who was an army officer and at this time was a kind of protocol officer, a higher officer in Austro-Hungarian army, with my aunt Helena, who didn't, was no need to conversion, you know, he was very tolerant. And she always had candles on Friday, that I remember, because I used to have a room in the apartment. You know, we are living in the same house. They were living, we had in the front a larger apartment because there were many children. They were only my uncle and my aunt. They were in the back apartment, like the houses are built over there. And one room they gave me, you know, I had over there as a small child. So I was most of the time I spent there. And frankly, I took my uncle Zabielski to the church every Sunday. And he was very attentive that my aunt has her candle on Friday.
Now, your aunt, how was this aunt and uncle related to you? Through your mother or through your father?
The uncle? No, the uncle was from outside. Only my aunt was the sister of my mother. Yeah.
So he was a Christian when he married
was Roman,
her.
Yeah, he was Roman Catholic, yeah. And he was a devoted Christian, you know. But very respectful of the tolerant in religion. People do not realize that there were such people in Poland, you know. We lived together, after all. He brought me the Bible when I was a young boy, and he said, that is in common with us. He opened the Psalms, you know. And he said, that is in common with us. It's common to us. I remember like today. So he was a professional army officer. You know.
How did your family observe Judaism at home?
You know, not very much. Not very. The holidays my mother observed and my aunt observed. They would even fast, you know. But my father, not very much. They're very secular in this respect. So there were a rabbinical tradition in the family. It means when there was bar mitzvah, I was the only in the classroom who didn't have a bar mitzvah or a confirmation like the Catholic. I said to my father, what about me? You know, everybody has bar mitzvah. And my father said, you know, you remember, you like to go with your friend Karol Estreher to the Jewish section of Krakow, Kazimir. We loved to go, it was very romantic, and we knew every corner there. As in terms of history, of Jewish-Polish history, my friend who was Roman Catholic, very close, he wrote the first guide in the Jewish section of Krakow, and knew the Jewish section very well. And he said, you remember the, he indicated the synagogue, old 16th century synagogue. And he said, your grandfather was praying in the synagogue in his sneakers, not sneakers, whatever they had, you know, pantofles over there. And he had peace, so not to sleep overnight, only pray. And he said he prayed for all of us. You can go play your soccer game or your handball. He was a very pious man. You don't have to worry. But I remember that I had private religious education because that they gave me the, Dr. Rosenman was coming and he gave me lesson in Bible and everything. And then in gymnasium I had to take Hebrew lessons. You know, he was also the same Dr. Rosenman, very nice man, was in charge of religion in gymnasium, you know, very intelligent man. So I knew Hebrew a little bit. I didn't have talent for Hebrew. I learned other languages, but didn't have talent. Unfortunately, I would wish to know it's a classic language. But we didn't have too much of a religious education. But we knew very well that we are Jews, and we felt very strongly that we are Jews. And when we discussed at our lunch and table the anti-Semitism and problems like that, and our views. My father used to say very often, you know, gave us an example, Luzzatto, who was the prime minister of Italy, he was Jewish, and he was a very good Italian, and he was a very good Jew. Nathan was, in his times, was the mayor of, president of Rome, and that was a time of toleration in Europe, and I wouldn't say, you know, the term assimilation has very much was denigrated in the Jewish culture and in the Jewish parlance, But it was a time when Jews and Gentiles lived together. And after all, there was one social class, that was the educated class, which was Jewish and Christian. They were the same people raised in the same school. Everybody was assimilated to the modern culture. Everybody, a Polish nobleman who went around with his sword one time, had to be assimilated to the culture of the Enlightenment and later to the modern culture. And very often this fact is overlooked, that that was one of the most important social classes in Europe. The intelligentsia.
You describe the relations as being quite good between... Did you ever experience any anti-Semitism at all?
I don't think that there is a Jew who didn't experience anti-Semitism. But the problem is that the peasant experienced also situation of humiliation. It was a class society, very strong, with very strong class feeling, and very strong spirit of domination, of class domination. But they were already people who were strongly opposed to anti-Semitism among Gentiles. And I was raised in a society which was both Gentile and Jewish, and my family was both. And I must say, in my family, I never felt, on the part of my non-Jewish members, never felt anything but love and friendship. And so much love that I never forget. My sister-in-law, Zosia, of my brother Otto, she was Roman Catholic. He was Jewish. They both were physicians. When he left and moved east, when the Germans came, she didn't abandon him. She could go, her mother had an estate, she could spend with her two children, Jasi Małgosia, Hansel and Gretel, two little children. Now she went with him, she said, no, we are together. And later, what I learned from a letter of Ukrainian who wrote me, he was a physician in a Ukrainian section, helped the Ukrainian partisans who were anti-Germans. The whole group was shot, was burned by the Nazis, by the SS, in the village, the whole population. The whole, when they got them, they put them in the church and the bed, together with, and they killed these children, they killed my sister-in-law, and they killed my brother. And she perished with him, she was Roman Catholic. My other aunt, to the last moment, didn't leave my uncle who perished in Auschwitz, Daniel Gross, who was senator from the Polish Socialist Party, from the western part of Poland, who was member of the Polish Senate, from the Social Democratic Party.
How did World War I affect you as a child and the rest of your family?
World War I or two?
One. Let's start with World War One.
You know, I remember not so much, but my father was in Vienna. Some of my uncle Martinek was, of course, on the front, on the Turkish front. He was at Gallipoli. He was artillery officer. He was professional artillery officer. My father was in the parliament, very active and also strongly opposed to certain policies of the government. So when my brother Maximilian, the oldest, was called to colors at this time, when he finished gymnasium, he was put immediately into the Austrian officer school at 18 years. I remember my father had to buy him a horse, you know, because he was in the transport section. And in 19, he was sent to Albania at this time, because, to the Italian front. And he was on the Italian front, on the Albanian front, the Italian. And my father was in the parliament, very strongly, very critical of certain policies of the government, part of the Polish club, of the Polish, the Polish members of the Polish parliament, Polish members of the parliament formed a single club, Democrats and Conservatives together. The Social Democrats stood outside, but my father was a Democrat. And he didn't intervene about my brother, and so he said that there are serious problems other than that. And they were relatively, the years for us were not so difficult as for the rest of the population, because we could manage, but we didn't have any privileges, because my father in this respect was very strict, that we shouldn't have better than the rest of the population. But I went to the gymnasium, and I cannot complain, you know.
What was your gymnasium like?
My gymnasium was very pleasant, you know. It was a very good gymnasium, one of the best schools.
The name of it?
Yeah.
Can you tell us the name of the?
Sobieski Gymnasium. St. Anna and Sobieski were the two best schools. In St. Anna Gymnasium was Joseph Conrad, one of the students, you know. And it was a school which had its origin in the 16th century. Our gymnasium was much younger, from 1882, and the buildings were at this time considered very modern, you know. They were already old by United States standards, would be probably torn down. And it was a very good classic gymnasium. Education in Poland was very good since medieval times. It was a poor country, but had always a very good education, a very good scholarship.
What were your particular academic interests at that time?
I was interested always in social problems, you know. The war affected me very strongly. The misery which the war has resulted into, the cruelty of the war, the suffering. I saw the hunger because I saw the children, poor children begging in the street. People coming by back door to our house, and my mother feeding them, giving them soup and bread, you know, whatever we could. It was an awful time, you know, to see that for people in this part of the world. And I felt rather bad, you know. I felt always like a guilty feeling that I do not suffer with the others, that I have it better a little bit, you know. And the same thing, my father, my brother was in Albania, you know. My uncle's nephew, I remember his first name, Nestek, was also a military man, professional. And he somewhere perished or disappeared in the fortress of Przemysl at this time. And my uncle Martinek was in Gallipoli, you know. It was a time where my father didn't believe that the Austro-Hungary is going to win from the very beginning, you know.
Was he active in Polish politics after the war, your father?
Only in social politics, in building cooperatives, housing. That was his main
interest. So he was interested in social problems as well as you were.
Yeah, well, you know, it came from, my father was not a social democrat. He was not a socialist. He said to me that when Viktor Adler asked him after the law has been passed, the head of the Social Democratic Party in Vienna, publicly during a luncheon which they gave at this occasion, why didn't he join the Social Democratic Party? He said, I do not want that Lueger, the anti-Semitic leader, that Lueger decides what we eat for breakfast. You know? He was right, you know, after that. And he was a liberal man of liberal views.
To go back to your gymnasium a bit, how were the relations between the
very good.
Jewish and the non-Jewish?
Very good. Yeah, very good relation. Very friendly. I must tell you, as I remember today, the Jewish students separated by themselves. It reminds me a little bit when I later, you know, I saw in the college the same thing in Brooklyn College, the black students. We didn't want them to segregate, but they formed the, when they came to the lunchroom, they sat together and spoke among themselves and didn't join. Later it changed, but we saw this self-segregation, which was not imposed by the college, my lord. You know, we were all against it. And here was the same thing. They were sticking together. Some of us did not. Some of us, it was a replica of what was in the society. Some of the students mixed, Christian and Jews. And some were segregating by themselves.
Which not kind of student were you? Did you mix?
Oh, we mixed from the, of course, you know.
Were there Jewish teachers there?
In our gymnasium, there were very few Jewish teachers, you know. In there were not very many opening. The high school was very elitist. They were, in reality, it was not like here. It was a middle school which was open to everybody, but gymnasium were rather elitist, I must say, to the detriment of the entire culture, and our education much more open. You cannot compare him. But you had very few teachers. It would be also very difficult for a Jewish professor to get a job, so I shouldn't be so partial, because there were some excellent Jewish professors in classics, I remember. There's some excellent professors here.
Did you go on for further education after gymnasium?
I went to the university, to the Aguilonian University. I had to choose the law because I knew that in the existing condition, it was very difficult to get into university and make a living in the university, not only for a Jew. There were very limited opportunities, and they were not paid. You know, when you were a docent, you were not paid. You had a venium legendi, it was called. You had the right to lecture. I was assistant sociology. I was the first assistant sociology at the sociology chair of Krakow, because there was no sociology chair before, with Professor Jan Stanisław Bystroń. Not paid, you know, also not paid, but I enjoyed it very much.
What year did you get your degree?
It was 1930s. I got first my 1929-30. I got my degree as Master of Law, and then my doctoral degree in jurisprudence and public administration. I had to write a dissertation. I went abroad to the libraries to get my material. And I worked at this time at the International Labor Office. I was a stagiaire, that's like a grant. You work in the office and you learn your profession with the League of Nations. I was about half a year. And then I got the Carnegie Scholarship in Paris from Mrs. Wilson. She was a cousin of the president and the head of the foundation. I was selected like a miracle, I must say. It was I met them, the Carnegie people, at Professor Hersch's house. Professor Hersch was excellent professor of statistics at the University of Geneva. And he invited me. I think it was his purpose that I get the scholarship. He didn't. Very nice man and very good statistician, a Bundist, of Bundist background.
So you went off to Paris?
And then I got the scholarship in Paris.
So how long were you in Paris?
About half a year.
Do you recall which year it was?
It was 19... just a second. I have it in my CV, you know. It was around 1930, 1929 or so. I shouldn't have returned to Poland, but I did. You know. And so I learned a good deal. Later I went very often to Germany, to Berlin. And again, on the Weimar Republic, for instance, the universities were very respectful. I wrote a letter to many German professors who were opposed to Hitler. But I remember I wrote a letter to Professor Kunov from the University of Berlin. He was an ethnographer, but also historian of economics. And after Friedrich Engels retired from Die Neue Zeit, which was a socialist review, he asked Kunov to become the editor. He was a great Marxist in the humanistic sense, and social democrats very strongly opposed to communism. And I wrote at this time a book in social anthropology and nomadism, and I needed someone who knows the literature of 19th century. Well, I thought Kunov will know. I wrote his history of economic history, so I thought he will know. I wrote him a letter. I had no problems. I was sitting a week in Berlin with him. He would give me every day a few hours and talk to me. And wherever you went, they were, you know, it was a small academic community at this time, open to all.
Was this before 1933?
It was before 1933. And I went also to the Museum für Völkerkunde. There were many people who were open. But later, most of them joined the Nazi party. Only two, three didn't. And that was very painful, you know.
When was the last time you were in Germany?
I crossed Germany after Hitler came to power. I went to England to see my mentor, Professor Malinowski, who was professor at the University of London, the famous anthropologist. And I went there, I used the library of the British Museum, and I went to his seminars. That's how we studied. We didn't take, you know, the whole year of studies or so. Courses, we didn't go for, once we had a doctoral degree, we didn't go after other degrees. We just went to the university, studied a semester with a professor, without even registering at the university. Knew the professor, he invited you, you came to his classes, to his seminar. And so I used to go to England, but I crossed Germany. It was frightening to see the tremendous change in comparison with England. The barbarity, the oncoming barbarity. And at this time it was the young people, like my friend Karol Estreicher, myself, who went to Germany, who saw the danger coming. The older people, when you spoke in Poland, they didn't believe that it will come to the war. That was the, they thought that Hitler is a passing phenomenon. I remember I spoke to Rector Estreicher. I got a letter to give a lecture in Berlin, and I was a young man. Just published an article on migration, on primitive migration, a systematic discussion, classification of migration in a German scholarly journal, Der Weltkreis. And they told me whether I wouldn't like, that it would be good if I have a lecture over there. And that was a great for me distinction. And I said, of course. And then in the meantime, Hitler came to power. And the head of the museum, Professor Kreutz, I remember like today, T.H. Kreutz, wrote me a letter to come, even a handwritten. I went to the rector of University of Krakow, Stanisław Estreicher, who was my mentor and my doctoral advisor, asked him what to do. He said, you wait 6 months, it will be over. I said, Professor Estreicher, in 10 years it won't be over. I saw it. It's a catastrophe. He said, oh, in 6 months it will be over. Hindenburg will do it. They believed in the President Hindenburg. And so was my father telling. Rector Estreicher died in the German concentration camp as a rector of the University of Krakow. He was Roman Catholic.
What about your brothers? Did they feel that there was a danger coming? Or did
No. You know, you had to go through Germany to see this. And if you knew before, if you knew Germany before, I knew very well because I was in contact with German pacifist movement. I was active in student organization, in the pacifist organization, in Krakow. You know, we had, it was a very good organization, student organization. The only left-wing organization, liberal, not left-wing. The Americans are afraid of this left-wing. The whole progressive, left of the center.
We have to stop now. We'll continue on the next tape.
Would you like to have...
This is tape number two. Today is November 10th, 1999. This is an interview with Feliks Gross. You were talking about being a member of a pacifist organization?
Yeah, Akademicki Związek Pacifistów, the Academic Association of Pacifists. We were European Federalists and League of Nations people. And we had social democrats, socialists like myself, people from the peasant movement, Zionists, Catholics, all liberally oriented groups. That was the most strongest liberal group at the university. The universities were in the hands of the right-wing students, of the fascist movement were strong at the university. Whether in Paris or in Warsaw, the right-wing, anti-Semitic, xenophobic, they were strong. We were opposed. We were opposed to any nationalism. Nationalism is a disease, you know, for us was a disease.
So about what years was this?
That is the whole interwar period. The nationalists came very fast to the power.
And you were in touch with pacifists in Germany at that point?
At this point we were we had very close relation with pacifists, not only young students, but the older generation. I remember very well General von Schoeneich. It was a Prussian general who was shot by the Nazis. He came to Krakow for a lecture. I remember because I waited for him at the railroad station, and we had still a horse drawing droshkes, you know, car. And when he came, I invited him to a taxi. I thought, you know, to bring him to the hotel. Oh, he said, not. I haven't seen this type of a car, long time with a horse car, I go by it. Then was Heinz von Kraschutzky, who was from the German Navy, who went with the German sailors to Berlin during the revolution. He was not a socialist or a communist, nothing like that. He was a pacifist. He was a strong pacifist editor of Das Andere Deutschland, a pacifist paper. By the way, when I had lunch with Pastor Niemöller later, you know, at Brooklyn College, even we had a very nice conversation. And I asked him just in a conversation with that he knew Hans von Kraschutzky, because he was a Navy officer and he was a Navy. That was my best friend in the Kadettenschule, you know, when they were cadets. How interesting. On one hand, you had a decent pastor, and you had a decent minded man, even in the German Navy, you know, of this. Then Professor Wilhelm Friedrich Förster, who was a great pacifist, was between us was generation of a difference of a generation. He was almost of the generation of my father.
Did you have any contact with these German pacifists after 33?
Oh yeah.
You still were able to keep
in
touch?
Oh yeah, we were helping them to get out from Germany. They went through Poland, you know, many of them. We helped them to escape. I was trying to engage my friend who had a good, very good position up in Silesia in Katowice, but he was not very much willing to help, you know, he didn't want to risk his job. But we were helping them, and then, you know, during the war in the United States, I met them, the Germans. Also, you know, when you said every German is bad, there are no good Germans, absolutely not true. The first people who were in the German concentration camps were Germans. We were organizing meetings, a pacifist meeting, when Osiecki was put in the concentration camp in Germany. We had a meeting in Krakow, protesting. I was very active in it. So, you know, and I had great respect for these German pacifists and left-wing people who was fighting back in Germany. When many people in England and others were pleased to see Hitler coming to power. This is a very dangerous thing to generalize, to consider all the nation as a monolith. The nation is not a monolith. People are different among them. You have to look at various groups. The same thing in Poland, you know, my experience. Some groups were anti-Semitic, but others were not. You know,
In addition to your academic work before the war,
yeah,
were you practicing law at all?
I was practicing law and in my father's office, and my father was very tolerant to my scholarly weaknesses. And
what kind of law did your father practice?
My father was corporation lawyer, you know, and had a very large corporation, like Skoda, IAG, there was a large corporation which had the investment in Poland. But he also was a political lawyer as a member of the parliament, defended people. But for political defense, he didn't take any money. That was the principle. The legal profession was a little bit different over there in this respect. And we defended with my brother Zygmunt. We defended in many political cases.
So your
especially
brother Zygmunt
the communists,
was
yeah.
a lawyer in with your father and
yeah.
you?
No, he was not with my father. He was independent. My brother Maximilian was and myself. And he was independent. But we defended very often in communists. That helped me, you know, after when I was escaping from the Soviet. When I was on the station, radio station, Lida, a man who had to arrest me from NKVD happened that was member of Życie, was a member of the student communist organization. And he helped me to get into the train, to my wife, me, and a whole group of people, and to get out of the Soviet Union.
Well,
and he was a member of the communist organization. He remembered me.
We'll talk about that in a
yeah.
minute. You mentioned that you could see the situation was going to become
the
very
younger
dangerous.
People saw.
Did you think of making any plans?
You know, it was very difficult intellectually. I got, you know, again, there was anti-Semitism at the universities. I couldn't get my habilitation appointment at the University of Krakow. But Malinowski, who was had the doctoral degree from University of Krakow, was professor at the University of London. At this time, very well-known anthropologist, you know, work. And I used to go to his seminar in London. He wrote an introduction to my book before. It was, I presented my work in the Polish Academy of Sciences, and after the Academy recommended for publication, which was published by a very serious publishing house, which published scientific books in Poland, Kazamianowskiego. And Malinowski wrote introduction to my book. And later he invited me to become a lecturer at the University of London for 1939. And I'm listed in the bulletin of the University of London for 39. Probably the first offering of urban anthropology was mine, you know. And I figured over there, he suggested my name, and I was approved by the London School of Economics. And I got a letter from Professor Carl Sanders, director of the London School, that I would be paid £50 a term. That was a large amount of money this time, as the assistant of Professor Malinowski, because lectureship didn't pay, you know. Docent was not paid in the European education system. And I was ready to go with my wife. I was dreaming about it. That was my dream, to get out of my legal profession, to go only to the academic. For a time, I was combining both professions, academic and legal. I mean, scholarly and legal. And but we spoke on public meetings all the time against Hitler, against fascism, against Nazis. You see, you cannot do both. You cannot tell everybody to fight back and yourself to escape. It was a foolishness, but my wife was very courageous, was a great lady.
Now, you've mentioned your wife, but we haven't discussed your meeting your wife and getting married. When did this happen?
I met my wife. I met her, it was not, you know, there was a line in Krakow, like Fifth Avenue here, where everybody walked. There were, over there was a cafe, and it was a kind of promenade like that. She came from Wieliczka by train, it was close to the university, and used to go through this AB line on marketplace, a big marketplace, medieval, one of the largest in Europe in medieval. And I liked very much her, you know, when I saw her. She was a very handsome lady and very, seems to me very friendly. And I thought that one time I would have to meet her, but I didn't know how. And my friend Carol Estreher, who was assistant professor at the art history, he said, we have one Jewish student. Because this was, you know, art history was studied by very few people at this time. And usually it was studied by wealthy people, you know, who could afford it, an aristocracy. And she said, we have one Jewish student. She's a very handsome young girl and has unusual name. She said, when they ask everybody to say the name, she said with pride, Priva Baidov. It sounds very beautiful. He said, it's really unusual, you know, Priva, it's not a Jewish name, looks like a Spanish name. And he said, you should you come sometimes, you will perhaps meet her. He said, I have no time, Carol, for this type of things. You know, it's a serious situation. But I had to come to his office, you know. It was a very funny situation because I belonged to it was a very small group. We were in opposition to the government. But he belonged to a small group which was in contact with General Sikorsky and Paderewski, which were already abroad at this time, through his father. And from time to time, he was printing leaflets against the government, very strongly worded. I suspect that his father also, it was rector of the university, and he was hiding them in the... There was a mummy in the art department. There were, you know, various examples of art. One was the Egyptian mummy, so he put it over there in this wooden cover which was there. So he said, you have to come, I will show you where I have the leaflets, you know, against Beck, Colonel Beck, you know. And he said, and here was sitting my future wife. And he introduced me to her. And that's how I met her at university.
And when did you get married?
We got married in 37. Yeah, in 37. And that was earlier, 37. Look, at this time, you had out of a sudden German art historians in his Zakwad, in his institute, coming in. It was just right when you went to Collegium Novum, on the right side, the whole wing was art history on the first floor. And my wife was sitting, future wife was sitting over there at the seminar studying. And I would come to see Carol Estreher, to see my future wife. At this time I knew her. That was the same girl, you know. Mm-hmm. And he said to me, look, this man is from this university, from other. You know why they study? They already make the inventory. They are coming here to steal everything. But we cannot tell them no. They are academic people. They came. They're making preparation long ahead. So we didn't have any doubts what they are cooking. It was even, you know, for us was very funny. I remember once I was called. It was... The Polish foreign ministry, and said they never asked me for anything. What happened? There is a delegation of British students from Oxford. It was some kind of Oxford association. I don't remember the name I used to know. A pacifist association. And we had a meeting with them. They asked us to have a meeting. I said, of course we will see them. There was a whole small delegation. And they were starting to preach to us that we are conducting, that we are warmongers, that we are warning about Hitler. I said to the girl, she was very bellicose, you know, she was very aggressive. I said to her, you know, Breslau, a large German city, has a university. There were Catholic pacifists whom we used to see here. They are all exiles now. We help them to get out. There is nothing remains of it. If you wish to preach pacifism, go to Germany. Why don't you talk to them? Then come to us and tell us that you do. You know, they were coming. People over there in England didn't realize.
So
we did realize we were too close to them. The last time I was with Adam Ciołkosz, who was a very prominent leader of Polish Socialist Party, very close friend of my brother, and my, in spite of the difference of generation, for whom I had a great admiration, member of the Polish Parliament, same. Last time we were on German Silesia, Upper Silesia, in Gliwice, now it's Gliwice, it belongs to Poland. Tremendous meeting of the workers, of the coal miners. And we spoke from the Polish Socialist Party. And they had from SPD, from the German Social Democratic Party speakers together. We were speaking against war and against Hitler. It was not yet Hitler in power. Treviranus was at this time Minister of War, of Defense, and he started the German rearmament. And we spoke against German rearmament. I remember like today. And we were all surrounded by Schupo, by Schutzpolizei, by the police. It was already very dangerous.
You were talking about being prepared to go to England.
I was prepared to go to England.
And what happened with that?
You know, I went to Warsaw, I remember like today, spoke still with Niedziałkowski, was the editor of the Robotnik Polski, of the Polish Social Democratic Daily, very prominent member of the Polish Parliament. And I said to him, listen, I don't know why I asked Niedziałkowski, but that's how it happened. I have this appointment at London, and on the other, it's a problem of how do I look like, you know, to go now, leave for London and leave you everybody. I am not a member of the Central Committee or anything very prominent, but it's a problem of simple honesty, you know, of those who. He said, go immediately to London. It will not, we will not be able to defend ourselves very long, and we will need people in London to speak for us. I remember like today. He was executed by the Germans. After the Warsaw fall of Warsaw.
So when were you planning to go?
Big one?
When were you planning to go to London? When was?
Well, I said I have to be. Now, you know, there was no time for planning, nothing. It was a very difficult time.
Well, your appointment, when was it supposed to start?
It had to start in late fall, you know.
39,
yeah. But it was just about. I had everything, we could go. It's not any act of any, it's a simple fact that we were preparing slowly.
And it just didn't happen in time that you left.
Yeah.
So how did you hear that that Germany had invaded Poland?
It was strange, you know. My wife was in air defense. And at the morning, we saw suddenly planes and bombardment. And my wife said, it's war. I have to get ready and go to my air defense section. And she was very courageous and very duty bound. And I said, it's not war. There must be, you know, exercises. I didn't believe it's war. I thought, you know, I didn't feel it. And that's how war started, a beautiful day. We didn't believe it's war. Absolutely unprepared. And Poland was not prepared for war. It was prepared for war in Napoleonic times, you know. It was awful when they moved in, you know.
Did you see the Germans coming?
No. We just escaped in time, you know. But we came under the Soviet occupation.
So as the Germans were coming into Krakow?
We were, when we were on the bridge between Podgórze and Krakow, and that I remember very well, you know. The bridge was empty, and I said, Priva, we have to cross it fast. And there were Polish flags on one side, the anti-air. And there were two German planes which were flying over us, crossing and shooting at us, two civilians with knapsacks. And we just were hiding against the pillars. And when they crossed, we ran. And finally, we ran under the Polish flag and said, you know, air artillery nest which was there. And from there we started to walk. But for a moment we were really exposed on this. And later several times we were under fire, you know, German fire, during the when we were retreating to the east. And finally we came to the Soviet zone.
Now when you say we, who was with you?
My brother Zygmunt, his wife Jadzia, his first wife.
And your wife?
My wife. And they were his friend Zygmunt Rapaport. And they were two young boys who joined us and asked to help them. You know, they were feeling helpless, and we said, okay, well, what, they were hungry, so what can you do in such situation?
Now, at the spur of the moment, when you didn't expect the Germans to yeah. be there, how did you make that decision to go?
When we were told that they are entering the city, we said, we like to go into the mountains. We are always prepared to go in. We had knapsacks and good shoes. You know. I said, take your knapsacks, load food. Let's take money, some money. And I said to my aunt Zabielska, because she was living with us, my uncle died. I left her money, and I said, I have to go. Because of, I said to my mother, I cannot wait, because I'm in a dangerous, you know, I was engaged in all these things. We took just a knapsack, that's all, with food and with change of clothing and documents.
At that point, where did you plan to go? What was your thought?
The thought was very simple, because we were asked to move. There was an appeal from the government that all those who have mobilization card, I had mobilization card, should move east to the next mobilization point. So we moved, you know, as they asked us to go. It was simply that way.
But you didn't know where this point was going to be?
That we didn't know. They said, you know, I don't remember. I still have this pink mobilization card somewhere.
So you just kept heading east?
And we are heading, you know, east. We were heading towards Lwów, towards the eastern town, because there my wife had... my wife's family was very, very Jewish, I must say, in a religious sense and traditional sense, from a rabbinical family. Her uncle, Levin, was head of the Aguda Israel and chief rabbi of Orthodox Jews, member of the parliament, very nice man. A metaphysic, I met him. When we came to Lwów, we lived in his place.
Now, you mentioned on the way you were attacked by Germans.
Oh, yeah, all the time, yeah.
From the air all the time?
From the air, yeah. And from the ground, too.
You saw Germans on the ground as
yeah,
well?
Yeah, yeah, too, yeah. But especially from the air, you know, all the time. There was panic, you know. You cannot imagine what the panic was. I was trying to make notes. I made notes, but I had to leave all the notes in Vilna, because going again out of Russia, you couldn't have anything. If you would have this type of note, they would shoot you as a spy. So, you know, I sat down on a hill at one time and made notes, a look at the people who were running. It was a complete... you could see a horse cart with people running with the credenza from the kitchen. From all things, they would save the credenza. And completely panicky. Panic of the entire population. And the reaction of the people who didn't move, you know, they could part move, but you had to go somewhere, was unusual, because some people were very friendly, and they will share with you with the last glass of water. Well, so many went that the wells were empty. There was no water. And some will not share even nothing. They will close the door. And so was it. The whole population was sharing this experience, with the exception of very few. Later, when the Soviet came, you know, the Soviet army was relatively friendly. Relatively, as far as my experience is concerned. My colleagues were someone before Soviet firing squads with no reason. But relatively, they were friendly. Afterwards, when the Gepo came, after the army, that became extremely dangerous and oppressive.
Now, when you arrived, how long did it take you about to get to Lvov?
I couldn't tell you now, but it must have been about 4 weeks or so.
And when you got there, what were conditions like there?
I will tell you. This I would like to say, because very often the Jews are accused of being very helpful to the Soviets and to the communists when they came, you know, by the Roman Catholic Pope. You have to look this way. On one hand, if they would stay under the Nazi occupation, there was a concentration camp and extermination. Under the Soviets, at least, they were not shot at because they were Jews, yeah? And then if they were sent to the concentration camps, like my family was, did, you know, they were like the other rest of the population. And furthermore, there was a tremendous opening for advancement, which was closed before. Of course, you couldn't compare the condition one side and the other. So for many people, the situation was very oppressive. They were going back to the German side. It was so oppressive. For me, for instance, too. Now for the pious Hasidic Jews also, but for the beginning not. But it is absolutely not true that the whole Jewish population was Prokofievist. It's complete nonsense. It was almost in no time, it was a network of Polish and Jewish underground organization, in no time. And the Jews were very well organized. The Poale Zionists, I had contact with Poale Zionists. Very nice people, very good people. The Bundis were very well organized. An underground organization.
What were you doing? What did you do in Lvov?
And we were rather short. You know, we lived in Rabbi Levin's place. And by the way, you know, here you have an Orthodox rabbi whose one daughter was married to a doctor who was immediately drafted in the Soviet army and disappeared. We don't know what happened to him, Paula. And her cousin, Franklova, and his cousin, her husband was in the Polish Legion during the First World War, so they arrested him immediately. He disappeared without trace. And we slept there. He was very nice and very hospitable, they were to us. We had long discussion. We did not argue, you know, on religion. I had a great admiration for him and respect.
How long were you there?
About 3 weeks in his place. He was killed later by the... And his brother, I was told, his brother came out when the Ukrainian took it over. He was offered by the Archbishop, by the Greek Catholic Archbishop. I have forgotten his name. He was uncle of my friend Michałowski. Was offered hiding place in a monastery. He refused. He said, I have to be with my people. And he was killed, yeah.
We have to stop. We'll continue on the next tape.
No, all right, let's go.
This is tape number three. Yeah. This is November 10th, 1999. This is an interview with Feliks Gross. We were talking about the 3 weeks. Did you stay beyond the 3 weeks in Lvov, or did you leave at that point?
At this point, I was warned by my friends that they are already after me. They are preparing to arrest Social Democrats, and my name was mentioned. And it was a strange thing, because first I met on the street a Polish writer, Adam Polewka, whom I knew very well. My wife never trusted his character. And just during the first day of bombardment, the first day when they were bombarding the, throwing bombs on Krakow, we were in Krakow for a time before they moved in, which when the city was already bombed. And we went to a coffee house and we met this man, and we were joking even, you know. Out of a sudden, he met me over there. He was already elected to some kind of the communist bodies. Must have been 4 weeks after that. And he was with a man whose name was Grosz, who later was a general in the Polish army and a prominent communist. I didn't know at this time. And he said to me, "We are after people like you." "What does it mean, we?" "I mean, he's already in," I said. And he said, we will come for you with a platform." I remember like today, because Adam Czolgosz, who was a member of the parliament, him we will take with a special car. And I didn't know whether it's a warning or whether he is simply, but I took it, and Priva told me, "You know, it's an awful man. We just saw him, but it's a kind of warning." And then came others and warned me. And then came a man with whom I befriended myself very well, who was one time a communist and was very disillusioned. His name was Stross, very nice fellow. And we used to meet in the house of the newspaper men and writers. There was a writer's house they made. And we all met over there, you know. And even those who were escaping and trying to. And he got a commandirovka. You couldn't get a ticket for the railroad ticket without commandirovka, without the permission from GPU. And so I couldn't get by railroad if I would do it myself. He had the commandirovka to go to Polish-Lithuania over there, to the borderland, and buy food for the newspaper and writer's house, you know, because there was not very much food, to bring food for the. He got the commandirovka and had the right to take 2-3 persons. He said, "Listen, Felek, I will take you and your wife, but no more." Then came my friend Ranitsky. He said, "You have to go, and I am with Stross." You know, at this situation, you don't ask many questions, you know. You cannot tell anybody that you are escaping. You have to be very careful what you are doing. And they told me the day we have to go meet at the railroad station, and that we will, from this place, we will, from at this hour, we move to Lida, to the Lithuanian border. The Romanian is already impossible to cross, you know. And so we met. The train really came full, but you couldn't even open the door because, you know, the door was closed. Then my wife, she took to the knapsack various kind of tools. She said, "We don't know where we are going to land. If we land in Siberia, anything will be good to have to trade." And she gave me a hammer. She said, "Take a hammer and break the glass." She said, "You are right." I said, "You know, when I break the glass, the conductor will come out because it's a Soviet train." Then I started to hit. When I started to hit, he opened the door. When he opened the door, we moved in. Hardly we moved in. We went 24 hours to Lida, standing. Do you imagine the train? Before the Polish trains, whatever the Republic was not so bad. But the trains were excellent. The railroads were excellent. Out of a sudden, everything was ruined when they came. There was no food, nothing. Absolute, you know, a disaster situation. So we arrived to Lida, and I went with the group. The group was a little bit enlarged by Otaszewski, Poznański, you know, two people, Jews and non-Jews. And there in Lida, on the railroad station, we were waiting for our train, which we were told will go to Yashune. The Yashune, we have to jump out from the train, and there will someone wait and lead us through the woods, you know, to the Lithuania, which was not, where were Soviet bases, but we were safe because they really kept to their bases. That was the best choice we had. We came to Lida, which was one time a clean, decent railroad station, like all the stations in railroad depots in Poland. Now it was like in a movie. People were laying on the floors, peasants were waiting for trains for days to get on the train, in spite that they had the tickets. Trains were late, and they were told us, you have to wait, it will go in the morning. That is the train. I was sitting next to a man on a bench. The others of my friends and members were just on the floor sleeping. I said, someone has to be awake. I will be awake. Sat next to him. He was looking for something. And I said, what are you looking for? In Russian, I asked him. He told me, for I broke my watch and I lost the hands of the watch, you know, I'm trying to find them back. I said, they said that this time the Russians came, everything is. When they came, everything disappeared, clothing, anything. They were buying everything, especially watches, you know, chassis. That was all. Said, you can get it. It's now Soviet Union. We have everything. We are a happy country. Then he turns to me, and here he has the either KGB or NKVD that I cannot tell you, a red armband. And he said, and you, Comrade Gross, where you are going? I said, everything lost. I mean, there's no way to play. You have to play it properly. I said, I am Lida, where I can go? To Lithuania. You have a papers? No. I said, no. If I had papers, I wouldn't be in Lida. I would be in the train. He said, why do you escape? You know, now is our, we are in power. You are an anthropologist, yeah. And you will teach at the University of Minsk. I thought, nice perspective, and later the Stalinists will come and shoot me and to change London to Minsk, you know. It was not a very beautiful perspective, and I didn't want to have anything to do with the Soviet Union. And he said, but if you want to go, he said, by the way, are you a member of any central committees of the Polish Socialist Party? I said, no, I am not in the Central Committee of the Polish Socialist Party. And in the unions, said, no, I am not even a member of the union. I am in Bar Association. Education societies. I was in the Central Committee of the Workers' Education Association. I was head of this school for workers, you know. He said, yes, then I have an order to arrest you. He said, so what should I do? I said, no, you have to escape. He said to me, you are a decent guy. You have to escape. I will follow me. So I said, I have no choice. We have to trust him. I walk up to the people. And I said, let's go to our train. I said, that's our train. He said, no, this is not your train. This train will take the people to Siberia. That is your train. It was a train, dark train, without light, without anything. It goes to Yashune. And he went through the tracks and took us home. And then there were old cars, you know, the Prussian cars, where every compartment opens outside. He said, you open one of them, you go in. And then he says, do you have guides? I said, we have guides over there. I cannot tell you who is the guide and what the whole group is, because he said, I didn't organize it. Trost knows it. I really didn't know anything. Just, you know, at this situation, you just do everything. It's based on trust. Just based on trust. And he said, you watch the guides, it's very dangerous. He said, at one point they will try to blackmail you and shoot you if you don't give them more money. You have to have some weapons. Do you have a gun? I said, listen, if you want to get me with a gun, have the courage. You won't do it. You won't get me with the gun. He said, you don't understand me. You have to have a gun, and a gun, you put it here. If you don't want it, he said, all right with me, but it's a danger for you. You don't understand me. I'm a very unhappy man. I have no way out. My name is Leuchter. I remember like today. And he said, I have a Russian wife. My only way out is down to the earth. I have to stay. If you are happy sometimes, then you will, he said, you remember me. And he had tears in his eyes. I was very moved, you know, and I felt that I hurt somebody's feeling. Was very. And he put us in the car. He said, a number of these incidents saved us during that. And, you know, we came close to Yashune. And again, the train didn't stop at Yashun, at this place where it should have stopped. So again, you know, then I said, you know, we have no choice. Let's pull the brakes. I pulled the brakes. The train almost, you know, moved. And we jumped out from the train. Happily enough, there was a Jewish bocher, you know, a boy who is studying the Jews were the Orthodox Jews, extremely well informed, very helpful, sharing the information, warning with you, giving you shelter, very decent during this period. That is my our experience. And he said, follow me to the shul. Follow me. He said, he was like praying, follow me and don't talk to me, but only follow me. We followed him, we came to a synagogue, and they were very friendly people over there. They told us, put your knapsacks here. He said, you have money? He said, we have money, everything. You have guides? We have guides. He said, you have to eat something. Go to this little restaurant here. And so we went, you know, and then come back and pick up your stuff. But don't go out in the street with the knapsacks, because they will see immediately that you are trying to go through the border. The border is here. And then when we are sitting over there, out of a sudden comes a truck with people with the blue, with this GPO, you know, recognized under the cars. Open up the truck, they jumped out with the big dogs. And the owner, Carsten Ellenbogen was his name. I remember like these things I do remember. He said, run. It was an excellent soup, you know, barley soup. We were so hungry. And I took my wife, we ran through the back. I don't know, it was a very high fence. I put my hands together. I said, Priva, put your foot here and jump through the fence, because that they asked to do. And she did it and succeeded. And I don't know how I went through it today. And then we were in the fields. We went a few yards when we came to a forest. Not few yards, 20, 30 yards, if I remember. And then one of the guides, a young man, said to us, follow me. All our things are on the carts covered with potatoes. The road is next to us, and we went through the woods, and our things were on this cart. And so we started to walk, and then story is very long how we crossed the green border in winter against with some guides, you know, who it was all organized by these people, and this whole network I didn't know. And that way we came to Vilna, you know. It is a number of coincidences that saved your life. It's really a fortune. But in those critical moments, you have to have the will and the decision to make it.
About when did you arrive in Vilna? Had the year turned already? Was it January?
It was cold, yeah. It was winter, yeah. It was very funny at one point. Very funny, I remember, because at one point they told us you will have to bribe the police commissioner to give you the paper, otherwise you would be in a difficult situation. He said, I never bribed anybody in my life. I don't know how to do it. And my friend Ranitsky had golden dollars. He changed them into lits, which were Lithuanian money, you know, some of them. And I said to him, Yashu, your father is very wealthy. His father owned the newspaper, together with Dombrowski, one of the largest Polish newspapers. And I said, and you must know how to bribe. He said, I never bribed anybody, but you are closer to it. Try it. He said, do it for me, try it. I knew him so many years. He said, I can try, but I am scared. He said, go and try it. I will not do it. And then he comes smiling. He said, it was very easy, you know. How easy was it? I said. You see, I came to the police commissioner, and I was keeping my the banknote of 100 lits, which was lots of money at this time, and not knowing how to do it, asking him for the paper. And he filled out the paper, he asked for a name, and then he looked around and he said, I have somewhere 100 lits, I cannot find them. They must be on the floor. So I lowered my head, took off from my pocket 100 lits, here they are, I found them. But they were corrupt, you know, but that helped, you know. Corruption is not the worst thing. If you could have corrupted Stalin or Hitler, it would be the Hitler was corrupted. And so we came to Vilna. In Vilna, I didn't know where I go in Vilna. I met in the street Arski, who was a member of the student socialist organization. On the street, you know, when we left the peasant cart, just by accident. And he told him, listen, we have here a kind of a hostel for writers, for scholars. We took over an apartment at Zygmuntowska Street 7, I remember like today, which happened to be the apartment of General Drescher, whose wife I met later in New York. And he said, we have one room for men, one room for women, one dining room, and we get food. Joint was given the food. The Jewish organization was financed. There were Jews and non-Jews. And irrespective of everything, it was the Jewish organization which was giving the money to the supporting. The American minister was coming from time to time. Mr. Norem was very friendly, but not very helpful. Not very helpful.
The How strange long were you in Vilna?
In Vilna, I was a year. And again, in Vilna, it was to admire how fast the Jewish organization, you know, they say that the Jews collaborated in Vilna. There were some Jews who collaborated. They were visual. But many Lithuanians collaborated. But they had immediately underground organization. They are very well organized. The Orthodox Jews, the rabbinical schools were sticking to each other. They were not collaborating with anybody. the Zionists have their network, and they had their networks. I remember when we were in danger, the Polish groups, I told them that the man Tyszkiewicz, Michał Tyszkiewicz, was a kind of commissioner for this underground commissioner for the district. He's in danger, that we will have to look for a way to get him out. It was a Poale Zionist, a young Poale Zionist, who told me, we have a Melina, it means a hiding place, in Riga. If it comes to a danger, we have the ways to take him over. They had the various routes, and then the Bundists have the organization. The Bund had the organization. Then the various branches of Jewish political parties. Warhaftig was there, who later became a minister for religion in the Israeli government. Kantorowicz, Poale Zionist. Czytrynowski, Poale Zionist. I had sympathy for the Poale Zionists. They were open-minded. You know, for me, the Marxism was a very closed idea. Scientific approach is method above all. And if you have a Marxist approach, your mind is closed entirely. It's like religion.
Now, what news were you getting in Vilna as to what was happening in the German part of Poland?
Big one?
Were you getting any news in Vilna?
Oh, we are getting all
what
the
was
time.
What was happening?
Yeah, we knew very well. It was, you know, appalling when we were under Soviet rule, that they were showing, it was not permitted to speak about anything what was going on in Germany with the Jews. But they were showing lynching all the time in the United States. There were posters showing lynched poor African-American by the American, about the prejudice in America. It was an anti-American propaganda all the time.
Did the underground groups there get word from what was happening from the Germans to the Jews in Poland from the Germans?
No. How the news were coming is hard to say, but above all, you know, we are listening to the radio all the time. We had news through the radio. And the Lithuanian, you know, the best paper in Vilna was the Jewish Yiddish paper. From this paper, you had a good deal of information.
Was there any concern that the Germans would get as far as Vilna at that point while you were there?
Some people were trying to believe contra spem spero, you know, to against the hope. We had no illusion. We had no illusion, you know, that they will attack sooner or later. I estimated 6 months. That was the plan of Hitler all the time, to take over Russia. And I thought that the Baltic states are foolish. I even said it to the head of the Lithuanian Red Cross. When, you know, they came to our club, let's call it, whatever you call it, hostel, you know. And they said that we are doing too much underground work, and we publish papers and so on. If it was true, by the way. And he warned us that if we continue, we will be shipped to the camp in Jagarek, which was a kind of concentration camp, Lithuanian prisoners camp. I said to him, he was envoy to Sweden, Lithuanian, before, and head of the Red Cross. I said, listen, do not threaten us, because it's for us today, for you tomorrow. I told him at this meeting. I think it was a little bit arrogant, but it was helpful.
While you were in Vilna, did you start to make plans to get out?
All the time, to be honest, you know, I couldn't take it, this whole thing. But my friends not, you know. They are courageous. For Mitzner, I remember, I told him, listen, we are ready to get out, and we can include you. He said, no, je suis, je reste. He said, like, I am here and I will stay here. And then I saw young Polish officers. It was amazing, you know, when we were in this group, when they went back to Warsaw from the Lithuanian part to German part. with nothing, just like they were dressed at this time. It was very funny because we said in Lithuania you had to be shaved and decently dressed. When you came to the Soviet zone, you were safer when you were not not shaved well and not very well dressed, you know. And they were, it was a very courageous nation, you know, the Poles and the Jews, both very courageous.
So what were the avenues that you could take to get out of Vilna?
We were planning with my cousin, cousin of Priva, Dr. Levin, who was later professor here at Yeshiva University. And he also was president of the Aguda Israel. His son, by the way, Nathan Israel, is a very prominent lawyer in Washington. He also escaped. You should interview him. He was 4 years old or 5 years old. He's in Washington. And not only me, but some other people tried to find the way, and they found finally that we are trying to go through the Baltic Sea to Sweden. But the fishermen already on the Baltic Sea were afraid to go because they were gunboats, Soviet gunboats and Nazi gunboats on the Baltic Sea. So that was closed. He went to Klaipeda, to Memel, you know, to the port town of Lithuania to explore the situation and how much they would take, you know. And it was closed. So the only way remained came out of a blue sky. This proposition, which was entirely connected with Levin. I will tell you the story perhaps in a moment, because the light bothers me. I have to interrupt for a moment. Is that all right?
Well, we generally don't stop the tape, but we'll be finished with this tape soon, and then we can take a break.
Yeah? How you can take the break?
Okay, we'll stop. This is tape number 4. Today is November 10th, 1999. This is an interview with Feliks Gross. You were telling us that your wife's cousin, Lewin, was making the arrangements to get you out of Vilna?
No, it's different. I will tell you the whole situation. He helped me very much. I will tell you the whole situation. In reality, the way it really the visas were given is described in Dr. Isaac Levin's last book, his collection of his various essays and studies. And one is on the way the Sugihara gave the visas. The wife of Dr. Isaac Levin was Dutch. She was a Dutch subject, and she came to the Dutch consul to get an exit visa. He said to her that he cannot give her a visa because she has lost her citizenship. She married a Polish citizen. But he wanted to help her very much. He was a decent guy. And he said, finally, after searching and looking, he said to Kiraso, you don't need any visa. It's a Dutch possession. They may not let you in. That's a different thing. But you need the permission of the governor. That's what I remember, you know, I repeat from my memory. And he said, I will give you a visa. I will give you in Dutch a statement that to Kira, so you are admitted without the visa, that I can give, honestly. And on this, the Japanese will give you a transit visa. And it did work. He was the first. That's how it started. Then the rumors went about it, and more people started to come to the Dutch consul for this Dutch visa to Curaçao, and then to get the Japanese transit visa. It is true that it was a situation when you had an American visa or a Japanese visa or even a steamship ticket to the United States, the Soviets will not touch you. They didn't want to irritate the great powers in these small things. They must have had some instruction. So that was a very safe thing to get. Now, I didn't take it because I couldn't, you know, I was at this time hiding in Kaunas. And I came with my wife. My wife applied. So on the list is my wife, Priva. And then the people started to get these visas. Not only Jews, many Poles got out, Christian Poles. And I came to my hero is Skoblin, the consul, Soviet consul, because he gave the exit visa, which was very important to get. And I asked Isaac Lewin, but I cannot go to Skoblin, to the consul, to ask for exit visa, because if I go there, you know, I have no reason. I'm afraid and that they will get me simply. He said, I will tell you what you do. You go with the Dutch people, who still are few Dutch people who are getting out, as the interpreter from Dutch into Russian. I said, my Russian is bad, but I don't know any Dutch. He said, you will speak English. They will speak English. They will not know whether it's Dutch or English. He said, all right, well, it's a chance. Okay, we go. There was a lady over there, his secretary of the consul, who was Lithuanian, who was very bad. And I go there, and finally, I did my duty, you know, translated to poor Russian. I would like to remember my Russian. I have forgotten everything. And then it was already late in the evening, and I'm waiting. It's already 1 o'clock. And he comes out from his office, and he said, you are waiting for what? He said, I would like to get a visa for myself. He said, still wait. I'm waiting. He asked me immediately what I want. I said, I want a visa. It was about 8 o'clock in the evening. And then I was waiting already. It was 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock. Then he calls me at a morning hour almost. I said, the strange thing to work in the office. He takes the telephone, asks the question. And I said, now I am lost again, like in Lida. He put the telephone back. He said, there is no one else in the GPU. He was a young man. And he says to me, listen, we know everything about you. If you do not disappear in 48 hours, you are in trouble. Not only you are in trouble, I am in trouble. I will give you the exit visa. Take your wife and get out as fast as you can. That's how I got out. I still have the Lydemas, the papers. And my wife was waiting for me. We sold everything we could to get the money, you know. And it was a funny situation because we had the money for the Trans-Siberian train, for which you had to pay in dollars. But to own the dollars was a crime. But you had to pay in dollars. That's typical Soviet. I had opened my toothpaste from the back and put in dollars. Came to the in tourist, opened the toothpaste and paid my money. If they would get me before in tourist, I would be in Siberia. When I paid in tourist, I could get out. And so we came to Japan.
You took the train across Russia?
Trans-Siberian train, yeah.
And then what? How did
Trans-Siberian train, we came to Vladivostok. And from Vladivostok, we took a Japanese boat. and on this Japanese boat, people were dancing when the last Soviet official got out of the boat. We came to Tsuruga. And in Tsuruga, I got already money from the Polish government in exile, some money. And there were Jewish organizations who took care for everybody. But many Poles went out. Mrs. Wabenska went out, the friend of my wife. They became very befriended on this trip. And I would like to say that it is not only the Japanese consul, whom I admire, and he was a nice, definitely a brave man, especially when you compare with the British consul at this time, because the British didn't talk at all to the people who were outside the crowds. And there was nothing, no help, nothing, for helpless, without any protection. When I see now the poor people who are displaced, I think they still have some protection of the UN. And the American, the minister was a very nice man, Mr. Norum, but he wouldn't give you the visa even if he had a telegram from Washington to give you the visa. He said, I cannot irritate the Soviet authorities. He told me point blank. He said, you have to pick up the visa in Moscow. It would be as you told me today that I have to pick up the visa in Afghanistan. It was as easy to go for us to Moscow without papers. You couldn't even buy a ticket. Nothing.
When was it that you arrived in Japan? About what time?
It was about January 41. Tremendous change when you came, especially at this time they were still all in kimonos, and first it looked a little bit like from the theater, from the what is the operetta of Gilbert Sullivan, when you see
Mikado.
From Mikado, everything clean and everything smaller. And then came the man from Cook and brought me the money. That was the interesting thing. And again, the difficulties to get the American visa in Tokyo. They had some information that we are from the underground organization, which we didn't deny that we were in the resistance. And we saw Germans going to Brazil everywhere, with no difficulty. But we were waiting, not only me. And finally in Yokohama, the new consul, came a new consul, and we were told to go to Yokohama. In Yokohama, he gave us within 24 hours. But at this time in Japan, in Vilna, there was, as I said, a network of underground organization. Jewish, and they were evacuated. They escaped that way. Otherwise, they would be victims. The Bundes and the religious organization and the Histadrut and the Poale Zionist and then the religious Zionists, which have a special name, which I have, Mizrahi, and very nice people, I must say, very good company. And we used to meet over there in Yokohama. And it was interesting because the man who took care for all of us was Mr. Katzman. Mr. Katzman was a Bundist. He lived in Yokohama and made quite money and became quite wealthy by trading with Siberian hunters for furs, which he exported to the United States. It's like from a novel. And he had a secretary who was Japanese student, and they were guiding us and assisting.
Now, when you, how long were you in Kaunas before you left to go to Japan? Because you had mentioned you were in Vilna for almost a year.
Yeah, we came to Kaunas back and forth and back,
So you were living in Vilna, but you went to Kaunas to make these arrangements?
We escaped to Kaunas,
Okay. And then you were in Japan for about how long?
3 months. Then, I asked, very funny was, I asked Katzman what happened if the Japan joins the Axis and attacks, what happened to us? He said, we have in Jewish and in Polish, Melina is a hiding place for thieves, which thieves. We have a Melina in Tientsin. in China. You have a Bundist Melina? He said, yes, I thought a Bundist section in China, you know, sounded fantastic. But everything was, you know, it was a network of people. He said that that is taken care of. We are in danger. never met later Mr. Katzman. The Japanese were very friendly, especially the students, but everywhere. They knew it is a racial problem. And they let us simply feel that they sympathize. But Mr. Katzman always said, be very careful, because they are all on service of the police, you know, the student. But they were very critical of their own government, of the war, the student. What I would like to say is that in Vilna, in the last moment, many of the Polish organizations went out also, of the resistance group, because they were very there were very massive arrests of the Polish resistance, and this time began. That's why I had to escape anyhow, you know. In any way, I had to disappear from Vilna. And it is, I heard or I read, I cannot tell you now because I could not remember, I wish I could find you the source, that the man who filled out the visas and prepared all that was a Polish official who served part-time in the Japanese consulate, who was a member of the Polish intelligence. And I remember, I have forgotten his name because I was given his name. That's a very interesting part. And that way, you know, he was able to put many of the Poles on the list. And in a sense, the assisted the Polish organization could get out too. I don't know the details. I was never made privy to this whole situation. But it is another aspect which is interesting, which doesn't diminish Mr. Sogihara's merit, but shows something broader, this whole problem. The Polish, one-time Polish socialists had very close with the Japanese. Strangely enough, during the revolution of 1905, the Poles were planning an uprising, like in 1863. And Józef Piłsudski, later the president of Poland, Joseph Piłsudski, and Tomasz Arciszewski, whom I knew very well, and I spoke to him about it, was the head of Polish Socialist Party, later prime minister of the Polish government in exile. I spoke to him here about this visit in Japan, here at Carnegie Inn, you know, behind Carnegie was a little restaurant, very good goulash. We went over there when he came to the United States, asked how it was. And they went to Japan to negotiate for Japanese assistance for the Polish uprising in 1905. It was Poles who were joined the revolution, the socialists, the Polish social democrats at this time. And he said the Japanese, now it turned out that the Japanese were suggesting something which was very demeaning for the Poles. They were Polish patriots. They wanted them to be an extension of the Japanese secret service, secret operation, you know. And they refused it straightforward. Said, no, we came here to fight, you know, on our own. We'll not serve you. But there were these contacts. And the Japanese were, somehow they were friendly the whole time with the Poles. The Jan Lerski, who was the Polish emissary, who went from Poland to London and back. And I knew all these people, you know, well, him and Jan Nowak, the other, Jan Karski, you know, we were in the same crowd, so to say. And I asked Lerski one time, I know, you know, Karski went through Slovakia and Hungary, but you went through Germany. Where did you stop? You had to sleep in Berlin. He told me, you will not believe. There was a Manchurian embassy, because at this time there was a Manchurian state. In the Manchurian embassy, the cipher clerk was our man. And I slept over there in the Manchurian embassy. So there must have been some kind of a second line in the Japanese foreign office. You know, they are intelligent enough to think that they have to think about alternatives, options. They didn't trust the Germans. They couldn't trust them. Bad as they were, you know, I don't try to idealize. I must say, our treatment was excellent for us. And I suspect that is more to it than the consul. That is much more, that it was tolerated on the very top. They knew what he's doing, probably. I must say, it was very interesting for us that they must have been very friendly to the Jews before, because when we came, the reception was made by a Jewish organization, very friendly. And the man who came to me and helped us at this time was very friendly, and I told him, I thanked him very much, and I asked him, what you are doing? He asked me what I am doing. I said, he looked around, you see this hotel? That was Oriental Hotel, I remember, like this, a big hotel. He said, I own it. I said, you own this hotel? Yes. And in 1917, I was carrying the packages here, and I came like you without money. So I must say, somehow the Jews survived in Japan and must have been, they were, compared with the Nazis and with the Soviet regime, as far as the exiles from Europe is concerned, the Japanese were quite quite generous, at this time, you know.
Now, how did you get from Japan to the United States?
Later, we got the visa in Yokohama.
And did you leave immediately?
We left shortly thereafter. I think it was in March. It was a big typhoon on the. And we came to San Francisco. San Francisco was the Jewish Labor Committee which received us. And my brother was at this time in Cincinnati. I went to Cincinnati. And from there to New York.
Had you decided before you left Japan that you wanted to go to New York?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Why
I wanted to see my brother. In
because
in New York,
here?
Yeah. In Cincinnati, my brother was here. My brother was in Cincinnati as a research doctor.
Which
know.
Brother?
Ludwig.
And then why did you want to go on to New York?
Because that was the center of the exile politics. You know. I knew that I have to go there. And there immediately it was my friend Krzyżanowski. I had friends immediately. And also instruction from London. And then I saw General Tsikorsky. I know the Prime Minister. I know him, you know. And we had long conversation. And I was elected as Secretary General of Central Eastern European Planning Board, which was a body like small United Nations for Poland, Czechoslovakia, Greece, and Yugoslavia. The four members of the executive committees were members of the government, ministers. Jan Masaryk, the Czech foreign minister, Sava Kosanovic, the Yugoslav minister of reconstruction. Then there was a Greek minister and the Polish minister, Steinczyk, minister of labor. And I was elected as a young man. I came from the country secretary. We were in charge of post-war planning for all of Eastern Europe. And we planned very early the Europe in terms of European federal system, trying to develop a regional federation for Central Eastern Europe as a part of European Federation. And that was later my work. Yeah. But it was very difficult at the beginning, you know, to start. My wife was very, very good, you know. She is also a good artist. She made silk screen and got a modest job to make for ladies' clothing the patterns, you know, to paint the models, and from that they made silk screen and made the clothes.
Were you able to get employment?
I got immediately, my friends who edited New Europe gave me immediately to write articles. I wrote one article, got $40, which was a lot of money. And later I got an article in New York Herald Tribune in the weekly edition, like the New York Times magazine. They had a magazine like that, and it was a feature story. I got $600 for it. And I shared it with the Harold editor, because he had to edit. My English was not good enough. And that was quite the money. And later I wrote a column for the Polish papers. My wife worked, and we managed. And then I was elected Secretary General. Then I had a salary. And I was also later made the editor of New Europe, which was a monthly review on post-war planning.
When were you able to get back into academic circles?
Rather very, very soon. You know, I had the Carnegie Scholarship in Paris as a young man, and I had contact with the Carnegie Endowment immediately. And they were very friendly to me, especially Malcolm Davis, the director of the Carnegie Foundation. It was rather funny, because I was in close touch with Professor Reinhold Scheirer, a German professor who was here from Tübingen, an anti-Nazi. I learned later that he represented the German resistance here. But they didn't know anything, you know, you don't talk about. And he was very much interested in my ideas of educational reconstruction in Europe and of education in Germany, the plans which I had of creation of a European university very early, internationalizing that. And he had an ideas of the International Office of Education also, which I supported very much. With my experience in the International Labor Office, I could give him information how to organize it and so on. And Dean Payne, the dean from the NYU, was interested in it. And one time I had a lecture at Wilson Foundation this time on educational reconstruction from the planning world. And the Dean Payne came to me and Shirer and said, we would like to have you on the faculty of the School of Education, like from a blue sky. And that's how it started. And later, Arnold Zurker, who was director of the Alfred Sloan Foundation, and was also in charge of a seminar on European integration, in which my friend Kudenhof Kalergi was also, you know, teaching professor of it. And when the planning board was dissolved, he came to me and he said, could you join our faculty? Well, I approached him, asking, but I wouldn't dare to suggest any appointment. He came to suggest to me. It was a very modest salary, $2,000 annually, but it was a beginning. It was very difficult, you know, when you refuse to go with Stalin and with everything.
Do you recall when you first heard about the full extent of what the Nazis were doing to the Jews in Europe, the camps, the gassing?
Very early. You know, when Karski came, he came to us to the same apartment from Columbus Circle. He called up.
He came, he saw you here in
New York? Oh, yeah, when he came. He came. He worked with my friends in the resistance, with Serankevich and others, you know, and brought me greetings from him. We became very good friends later. And he brought the information, the pictures. And I went immediately to Raymond Leslie Buell, whom I knew, who was in charge, who was head of the Time Life magazine, was a friend of Wilkie. And I have shown him this picture. Then in Time magazine was Raymond von Hofmannsthal, the son of the Viennese writer who wrote for Richard Strauss. Very decent guy, and Kurt Bloch. And I brought to them the pictures. We met in Central Park. There was a little cafe over there where there is now the zoo. And I said, listen, you have to publish these photographs. He brought them, Karski brought them, only the emulsion, you know. It was in a cigarette box. And out of this, they made pictures. And they didn't believe you. Hofmannsthal believed them. Bloch believed they were trying to push it through. The same thing Raymond Leslie Buell. But they didn't want to accept. They thought it's propaganda. Karski told me that when he came to Frankfurter, after the conversation, Frankfurter told me, I don't believe what you say, young man. You know, I remember when we were talking, I used to go around with my friend Tomasz Kuśnierz and with Karski. People didn't believe. Because after the First World War, during the First World War, there was a large propaganda about the atrocities of the German troops in Belgium, which were not true. And later, after the war, it was revealed that all this was a false propaganda. And so they told us always, but we had the same information about the Germans, and it was not true. And they didn't believe, you know. All is written up by Karski in his book, you know. And he said it, but he was extremely disappointed when he saw Mr. Roosevelt, President Roosevelt. President Roosevelt didn't, you know, reacted in it. Jan Nowak told me when he came and told to Churchill the same thing. And later when already the news was, we discussed with General Sikorsky. In fact, here in Hotel St. Regis, Joseph Rettinger, the advisor of General Sikorsky wrote, in my presence, and Ambassador Cichanowski was there and I was there, and they were writing a memo to President Roosevelt concerning the Jewish situation. And later I asked Rettinger what is all about, what is the, there was a plan to bomb the railroad tracks. He said, they said that that is one single goal, to defeat the Germans, and strategic reasons have to be considered. We cannot dissipate, you know, the forces. We have to prepare for this single, unique attack on the German war machine. And we cannot weaken our forces. Whatever it was quite possible to do it, in my mother's opinion, you know, but it has not been done. But as my, I must say that on the part of the Polish government in exile, as I saw it in Hotel St. Regis, and I spoke to General Sikorski. All was done to help.
We have to stop. We'll continue on the next tape.
I think I would like to finish.
Can we just do this now, and then we'll do it while we're setting up the pictures, you can make the call. If we could just ask the two questions. This is tape number 5. Today is November 10th, 1999. This is an interview with Feliks Gross. I just wanted to ask if you had any children.
Oh, I have a wonderful daughter. I wish I had more. And I had a niece. I have a niece which is like a daughter for me. And I have a nephew. My daughter is working in public health. She's an anthropologist. My niece is a psychologist. She's a wife of Leslie Samuels, a very good lawyer on Wall Street, who was assistant secretary of Treasury recently. Now, you know, he resigned. It was too much for him. And I have a nephew, Jan Tomasz, who is professor at NYU. He is... At present, at this moment, he's in Oxford lecturing.
And what is your daughter's name?
My daughter is Eva. Eva was born on a day when Montgomery was starting to defeat the Nazis in Africa. And therefore she was called Eva, because my wife said it's a new times begins. We are moving toward victory. And Eva is a wonderful, wonderful daughter. I cannot imagine a better child you could have in your lifetime, an ideal child, you know, devoted and decent person and extremely honest, has a very high ethical standard, as all the other members of the family. So in this respect, I was very fortunate. My brother Ludwig, perhaps I mentioned, is the discoverer of leukemia virus. It was a great article in New York Times when he died. And my niece now tells me, my niece was in contact, Augusta, she is, carries the name of my mother, that Gallo and was very close to him and used his method in discovery of the AIDS virus, and gives lots of credit to my brother.
What happened to the remainder of your family?
Well, it is not
very... Parents, let's start with your parents.
My mother died after Warsaw Uprising. She was hiding in Warsaw very successfully. Perhaps her looks have helped, you know. And also my colleagues have helped, because she was living in the apartment. And after the uprising, she either perished in Ravensbrück, I didn't push my sister to ask, or she was working, my sister told me she was working as a forced laborer on a German farm when she died. My youngest sister, Marisha, was in Ravensbrück after the Warsaw Uprising. She was hiding till this time.
They were passing as Poles and were sent to Germany with the Poles after the Polish uprising.
Yeah. Then my brother Maximilian was hiding in the forests of Lubelszczyzna and survived. And later was a counsel of the Austrian embassy in Washington. And my brother Zygmunt survived, also hidden by the Poles. Later he married his second wife, comes from this. And was professor at the University of Warsaw. My brother Otto really was a heroic person. And he died with my sister-in-law, Zosia, who was Catholic. And she could survive very easily. She could go to the estate of her mother and with two children, small children, Yashima and Gosia, Hansel and Gretel, you know. They were all killed by Germans.
What about your older sister?
My older sister with her husband, Speer, they were in the Soviet concentration camp, and they survived in Mariska Gubernia, you know. My niece, who is now architect in Poland, was inmate of a camp and went in the camp to school, all the school, lower school. They came back to Poland, you know. And then my sister got sick and died, you know, later. My niece is over there, and her son, Jan, is also an architect.
We didn't mention your father.
My father died before. My uncle Daniel, who was senator from the Social Democratic Party, Polish Socialist Party, in the Polish Senate, and he was killed. The news first were then in Silesia, but later it was officially written that in Auschwitz. He was in the early resistance movement, they got him. Well, my uncle David Dietrich Alexander was brother of my mother, perished also in the camp. I have so many people that when I wrote the book I wanted to dedicate to one of them, and then I started to list and I didn't know whom should I mention first. So I closed the book. I said, don't respect them other way. It's a great tragedy, which is extremely difficult to understand. You know, there is no any satisfactory explanation of the hysteria of Adolf Hitler and of the cruelty, a revival of cruelty, and a tremendous warning to the mankind continues that it may happen again.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Please tell us about the photograph.
Yeah, the, on the right side is my father, Adolf Gross. In the middle is my mother. And then is my oldest brother, Maximilian, on the left, and my sister, Felicia, on the right. The picture was made in Baden, close to Vienna, a resort place. And it was made at the turn of the century. It must have been around 1902, 3 or something. Looking at my brother, who was at this time 4 years old, it was around 1902 or 3.
How do you have these pre-war pictures?
The pre-war picture, either they come from my brother Ludwig, who gave me one time, who somehow got it from the sister of my mother, my aunt Ottilia, or they, after the war also, they found in the cellar of our house is a whole set of pictures which someone was able to save and preserve, also some family papers. It's amazingly that someone did it, you know, and they found it over there, and it survived. Yeah. Those are the pictures of my sister on the left, and all my brothers, 4 brothers, on the right, with exception of me. I was not yet born. So it must have been around 1905, 1904. And of course, Marisha, my sister, who was born in 1915, is not here.
What are the names of them?
It's Felicia on the left. Then I see Otto standing, then Max below, then Ludwig. Sigmund and Ludwig. Sigmund is the lower one and Ludwig higher up. You know. This is a picture of my father, Dr. Adolf Gross, around 1907 or so, and it's written that he's a member of the city council since 1902 and was elected to the parliament of Austro-Hungary around this time. You know. And this is taken from a newspaper which gave the pictures of all the newly elected members of the parliament. This is my mother, Augusta. A picture was taken just before the war. On the right is my uncle, Artur Zabielski, who was a Platz commandant. It's a protocol officer of the city. It's the city of Krakow, was a fortress of Krakow. And next to it is my aunt, Helena. She was a sister of my mother.
About when was this taken?
That must have been taken, I see, from the uniform and from about 1908 or 10, about this time. This is my uncle Joseph Martinek. He was a Czech and a husband of my aunt Malvina. She was a sister of my mother. And he was a very nice man. A Czech, and later became a Czechoslovak high officer, I think, a general officer. And he was on the front of Gallipoli at this time with the Austrian artillery. These decorations which he has are, thanks Lord, not German, only Turkish decoration and Austrian. This picture I made, it's my picture. I am very moved looking at it. It's my uncle Daniel Gross, mayor of the township of Bielsko-Biała in Silesia, Teschen Silesia, a senator from the Polish Social Democratic Party in the Polish Senate, and he perished in Auschwitz.
When was this taken?
That was taken in the 30s. This picture is made on Riverside Drive in New York. On the right side is my wife, Priva, And on the left, my daughter Eva. It must have been done about 1950. I am very moved even looking at this picture. A very nice picture. This picture was made in the 70s or in the late 60s, I think in the 70s. On the left side is my brother Ludwig, virologist, who discovered the virus of leukemia. Next is my brother Zygmunt. Then my brother Maximilian, and my own modest person on the right.
And the last name of all the brothers?
The last name, my name is Feliks, and then comes Maximilian to the neck.
The surname, Gross.
Gross, all the brothers are Gross, yeah. Perhaps you give this picture. That is in the center, Cardinal Wojtyła, later Pope John Paul II, I think the best pope as far as the Jews are concerned, in the history of the church. And he came to see me, to visit me in my office when he was in New York, and that here I am in my office as the director and at this time vice president, later president of the Polish Institute of Arts and Sciences. On my left is Mr. Pusłowski, who was my deputy. Later I see Mr. Gromada should be here, Professor Gromada, who was deputy. He was at this time Secretary General, now he's director. And there is Professor Błaszczyk in the top, and I think Bishop Wesoły, and Father Rojek from Brooklyn, and some other members of the Polish Institute.
Thank you. What year was this?
That must have been in 1980s, before his election to the papacy. In fact, my friend Franciszek Pusłowski told him at that time that he will be elected pope. On the left side is our house on Studentska 9. That's where I spent all my childhood and all my life. And it is now a very beautiful house, still not as well maintained as before. We own the house. It was a small townhouse, not more than townhouse. We had also some tenants, good friends. And on the right side is the other house, which my father was co-owner to for a time, where on the first floor was my father's office. And this window, which you see at the end, is the window from my office. It's just vis-a-vis the oldest Polish university, the Collegium, the ancient Collegium, now the library of the Jagiellonian University, the part of the library, which later was library.
Were these pictures?
Must have been done by my friend. That was done by my friend Karol Estreicher. Must have been done around 1950s.